morning, I want to thank Pastor Rick for giving me the privilege to baptize two very special young ladies. I'm going to be baptizing Alexis Alicias and Evie Fernandez in just a moment. And I want to read scripture before we do that, and then we'll pray. So listen to these words. And if you want to know why you need to be baptized, listen to Pastor Rick today. He'll tell you exactly why. It says, Jesus arrived from Galilee at the Jordan, coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, I have need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? But Jesus answering said to him, Permit it at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he permitted him. It says, after being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a what? As a dove, and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of the heavens saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the rich opportunity we have to begin the service today by seeing Alexis and Evie baptized. We thank you that they've given their hearts to Jesus and their lives to him. We pray that you'll grow them day by day as they follow this pathway of obedience to you. Thank you for this wonderful day, this wonderful worship service. Bless and guide in every way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Everybody say, hi, Evie.
Hi, Evie.
I'd like to ask all of our family and friends to please stand in honor of her baptism this morning. Let's give her a hand.
I'd like to ask if you feel comfortable, would you mind back me down a little bit there? Thank you. Mike, doing a great job. So, I'm going to ask you to stand if you're comfortable standing, and we'll do our call to worship to God be the glory. If you want to follow along in your hymnals, you can follow along on hymn number 4. Welcome. The God be the glory, and we're going to sing all 3 verses. If you're a guest with us, welcome. We have others who are coming down now who, if you would like to learn a little bit more about our church, who we are here at First Baptist, they have these little blue folders for you just to be able to go through and learn a little more about who we are at First Baptist. So there's a lot of things starting up this week, coming up soon. The youth group, they're going to start back up again on Wednesday. We'll be starting at 6:15. And so be sure to be there. We'll have food. We'll start off with game and worship and do all that great stuff. So super excited to get back going again after a little break from the summer and EDLs last week. If you look at the back of your bulletins, you'll see a QR code. This is for our preteen breakfast. So we started doing this last year, and we're going to kick it back off on September 12th at 7 a.m. So if you have a 5th or 6th grader that would like to join us for breakfast on Monday mornings, the form to sign up for that is here. We offer rides as well, so if you need a ride that morning, just let us know. We'll be able to organize all that. And so that QR code is the main thing that you'll need. So, Michael, I cannot see anything that you're holding up. So, but this Wednesday as well, we have team kits for the workers. Team kits starts next Wednesday, and this Wednesday we're going to have a worker volunteer meeting. So, if you are interested in helping out with team kit, that will be at 5:15 in the Phoebe Life Center. And so, Richard will be there, and he organizes all that. So, talk to him if you need more information, or just wait till Wednesday, 5:15, and for the team kit meeting. On Friday as well, the youth will be having a post-game party, a fifth quarter, after the football game. So we'll be here at the church. So after the football game, just come on over and we'll have a little party after the football game. So if you will, join me in prayer and we'll continue on with our worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your spirit is still moving for the salvation of those two girls, God, for seeing your spirit still save new people. God, we pray that your spirit would continue to move here in this building and outside this building, God, that we would continue to live our lives and as an example to what you have done in our life, God, of what Jesus has done in our life, but that we would tell others of the gospel, of the great grace and mercy that we have received, of the great love that we know because you have come down. God, you have come and lived among us. You have seen us what love is, that we are to follow like Christ in whatever we do. God, we pray that we would sing your praises this morning for how great you are, that we would lay anything down before you, God, that is hindering us, that is weighing us down, and that we would praise your name, for there are so many things to be praising you for. Jesus, in the name of prayer.
As we continue in our psalm and our worship, we're going to sing Count Your Blessings. And the thing is, guys, we are truly blessed, and I oftentimes say spoiled people, because our poverty level sets in the top 8% of the rest of the world. Not low-income poverty is in the top 8% of the rest of the world. And so as we do that as Christians, God has blessed us, and you need to take time to look around to see what he's doing in your life. In fact, that's what the Sabbath day was created for, to reflect and remember what Jesus has done. So keep your seat. We'll go, if you're following your hymnals, it's 644, and we'll sing all four verses of Count Your Blessings. will do that. Our next song will be hymn number 140, if you're following your book, and it will be Down at the Cross. And so I'm going to ask if you're comfortable standing, please stand with us as we do Down at the Cross and then sing all four verses.
The lame and the blind, and you will be blessed because
they cannot repay. For you shall be repaid at the resurrection of the just. This song reminds us that everyone is invited to the table, no matter what your past, no matter what. And it says, come to the table.
Personalness that he did with each of those two girls. I love that.
Knowing that we were having the baptism today, I began to think through the process of today. I wanted to go through a lot that the scripture has to say about baptism. Does the baptism save us? Does it not save us? Are we saved? Is it a symbol? What happens when we're baptized? Different things like that. I want us to go through. And let me begin just by doing this. I want to let us know and bring us in with the Hebrew mindset, the background of the Jews. Long before Jesus came, they were going through a process of baptism as Jews. In fact, back in the Levitical law, in the book of Levi and Exodus, when they came out of Egypt, the law that God gave to Moses included the fact that before they could go into the tent of meeting, he had to go through this washing process. In fact, what the Jews would do is they would build something like what we have as a baptismal up here, and they would have two steps down into it. They would have to walk through that in moving water. It had to be living water. That was a part of what they did. And then after that ceremony, they would walk up out of it. Then they would be clean enough to go into the tent of meeting, Moses would, to be able to meet with God. The Jews, when Jesus came about, as we're going to be reading the New Testament, there was such a thing as a proselyte Jew. You've heard that. You've heard that phrase before, a proselyte Jew. A proselyte Jew was a Gentile who decided in studying and watching the behavior of Jews in life that it was appealing. Something about this living God, instead of the plurality of gods, intrigued them. And the only way they knew they could do anything was through this system that the Jewish individuals had. And that was that I, as a Gentile, considered unclean by the Jews and by God and the Old Testament word, I would have to go through a process. The first process was that I had to offer a sacrifice. I had to bring that to them there in the temple that they had, whether it was the tent that they had going through the wilderness and all the way through until the temple was built. If I was poor, I would bring two turtle doves, and one would go through the process, much like somebody who was leprous would do. He would bring the two turtle doves. One would be washed and set free. One would have blood put on it, and it would be sacrificed. If I was wealthy, I would bring an entire oxen, the cattle, and it would be sacrificed in that process. That's step one. Being a man, I'd have to go through circumcision because Gentiles had not been circumcised. And to go through that process, that surgical process, as an adult man, you must really want to become a Jew. You must really want to be that. When that was done, when you were healed from that, then there was the process of baptism. You would go in, men, priests would be watching, you would strip down, you would walk completely down in the water, go through it, dunk yourself under, come up, come out. Once those three things were done, then you could be a proselyte Jew. Until then, you stood outside the synagogue and looked through the windows and listened. And so those were God-fearers. They were not yet proselyte Jews. And so when you read the New Testament through the book of Acts, you hear the stories of everywhere they went. Here were the Jews, but here were God-fearers, Gentiles, standing around the outside, listening to the stories. They had not yet got to the place where, I want to actually become a Jew. Because what would happen, whether you were Roman, whether you were German, whether you were from India, no matter where you were from, you gave up your citizenship wherever you were. And when you went through this process, you became
a Jew. Now, there was the court of Gentiles on the outside of the temple when it was built. You remember that? In the front, Jesus went through the court of the Gentiles, and the Jews had turned it into a den of thieves, his words. They were selling goats. Your goat was not good enough. You need to turn it in and get this one and buy this one. Your money's not good enough. You need to take this money that has been sanctified before you could give the offering. And Jesus turned over the money changers' tables and released the doves and chased out the goats and said, "You've made my Father's house a den of thieves." If a Jewish woman was going to come into the temple, move beyond the court of the Gentiles, she would need to go through baptismal process, running water cleansing her of the uncleanness that she had gotten by being out in public. She'd have to go through that to go inside the court of the women. If a man was going to come into the court of the men, he had to do the very same thing. If the priest was on the duty to do the sacrifice, he had to go through the very same thing every time. He had to go through this baptismal process every time he would enter in to God's temple. In that whole process, there were the Pharisees, there were the Sadducees, there were the Essenes, three different groups of Jewish thought in how you worshiped God. John was an Essene. He wasn't a Pharisee, he wasn't a Sadducee. He was an Essene. They lived out around the Dead Sea and where Masada is. And they lived in the wilderness. And so he wore a camel's hair tied around his waist, holding it, sandals on his feet, hair growing wild, lived out in the open. But the process of trying to bring anybody closer to God always depended upon going through running water. So when John came out of the wilderness and began declaring them to turn to God, and he would go into the Jordan River, in that process, the Pharisees and the Sadducees didn't think anything about that. That was a part of their system. If you were to approach God, you had to go through this cleansing. So doing that in the running water of the Jordan River was not a problem. So when they came out to see John, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, in the beginning of the Gospels, it was the most normal thing to them. They had been sent out, the Pharisees had, to talk with John to ask why he was doing this. They weren't upset that he was in the water, that he was baptizing all of these Jews. At that time, they were Jews who were coming in. Had he been doing it to Gentiles, they may have had a problem. You think? They would have had a problem. These were Jews who were coming and hearing. John tells us why he began to do that in that baptism. This is the Gospel of Mark. I'm going to begin reading verse 1 through about verse 11. Beginning in the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord." So he takes the Old Testament scripture, he sees what he's supposed to do. He was one who, when he was in the womb of his mother and Mary, had just received the fact that God's child was within her. As soon as she spoke, John leaped for joy in his mother's womb. As an infant in the womb, he worshiped in the presence of God. His whole life was given to this. Verse 4, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. So this is what he did. The baptism that John did when he came, it was for those to come confess their sin and to receive forgiveness from their sin. It was repenting of their sin. We know what repenting means. We're going to do the about face. We're going to turn the opposite way. We're going to walk the way toward God instead of the way from God that we have been walking, even as a Jew. That's what they were doing. He was declaring that. It was for repentance, for the forgiveness of sin, the cleansing that would take place through going to the water. And so Israel was coming out. So he appeared in the wilderness, verse 4, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea was going out to him, and all the people of Jerusalem. And they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. John was clothed in camel's hair, and he wore a leather belt around his waist. His diet was locusts and wild honey. And he was preaching and saying, "After me, one is coming who is mightier than I, and I am not fit to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandal. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Verse 9, "In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Immediately coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open, and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him, and a voice came out of the heavens, 'You are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased.'" If you still have your copy of God's Word open, turn over to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. Can you even imagine being so entrenched in religion, the religion of Judaism, the legalism of Judaism, having to always do the right thing, and if you messed up, you had to offer a sacrifice, and you had to go through all of this over and 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 over. And here comes this wild, woolly-looking prophet, declaring the forgiveness of sins through the washing of this baptism. Some people look at what we just read in the Gospel of Mark and think, okay, well, this baptism is what forgives us of our sins. No. No. This is a symbol. This is a picture of what has happened spiritually. The reason John came, John the Baptist came, John the Beloved, tells us. Verse 19 of chapter 1, the testimony of John. This is the testimony of John. "When the Jews sent to him priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, 'Who are you?' And he confessed and did not deny, but confessed, 'I am not the Christ.' They asked him, 'Well, what then? Are you Elijah?' And he said, 'I am not. Are you the prophet?' And he answered, 'No.' Then they said to him, 'Who are you?' So that we may give an answer to those who sent us." They were taking issue with him baptizing them in the river. They just wanted to know who he was. Verse 23, he said, "I'm a voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as Isaiah the prophet said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him and said to him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, saying, "I'm baptized in water, but among you stands one whom you do not know. It is he who comes after me, the thong of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These things took place in Bethany, beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, 29, he saw Jesus coming to him, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he on behalf of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who has a higher rank than I, for he existed before me. I did not recognize him. But so that he might be manifested to Israel, I came baptizing in water. John testified, saying, I have seen the Spirit descending as a dove out of heaven, and he remained upon him. I did not recognize him, but he who sent me to baptize in water said to me, he upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining upon him, this is the one who baptizes in the Holy Spirit. I myself have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. John's whole reason for baptizing in the Jordan River was he was looking for the Messiah. God had revealed to him that the way he would see and know who the Messiah was by reading the Old Testament scriptures, but who he would know it was because he would come, he would present himself, he would be baptized, and when he came up out of the water, the Spirit in the form of the dove would come and land upon him and remain upon him. Verse 35, again the next day John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked and said, behold, the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him speak. They followed Jesus. And Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, what do you see? They said to him, Rabbi, which translated means teacher, where are you staying? He simply said, come and you will see. A lot of times we will take John's baptism, which was a baptism for cleansing from sin, and we think that when I go through these waters of baptism here, that's when my sin is forgiven. That's not true. Sin is forgiven by Jesus. The moment we turn to him for the forgiveness of our sins, the forgiveness is there. But this baptism thing was throughout Judaism for cleansing, for them making their commitment to God, renewing that. And then in the process, as the church began, what we find happening in the book of Acts. You already know where it is. Acts chapter 2. Peter is preaching. Verse 29, he says, brethren, I may confidently say to you regarding the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. And so because he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn to him with an oath to seat one of his descendants on his throne, he looked ahead and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that he was neither abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh suffer decay. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. That is, remember, this is a story where everybody was hearing the gospel in their own dialect. So he has done this. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now, when they heard this, verse 37, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? Conviction came. What do I need to do? Anybody here a doer? If I have to do something, I want to do something. Maybe that's a man thing. Maybe that's more a wife thing than it is a man thing. At times we just want to know what to do. So conviction had come on their heart. Now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter, to the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? Verse 38, Peter said to them, repent, each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. So then, those who had received his word were baptized. And that day, there were added about 3,000 souls. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and doctrine. They were baptized as Jews, Peter, Andrew, James, John, the apostles. The whole religion that they'd come out of was this process of purification. Now, here this situation is, John had done that. Now here this has happened. And these are Jews that have come. Remember from the island of Crete and all those languages that were there. They all heard in their own dialect what Peter was preaching in their own heart. Conviction came. They want to be saved. They said, what do we need to do? Peter comes back and basically tells them, believe the message and then be baptized for the remission of your sins. Trust him in what Christ did for the forgiveness of your sins. These two this morning, same thing. Let me go back. I've shared my testimony with him, but let me go back. As an infant, my parents and my mom's family were United Methodists. What happens in a United Methodist congregation is, if your parents are wanting to dedicate their child, they come up and they have what's called a christening. And so they bring you up and the pastor sprinkles you with water as an infant and gives you your name and everything. And then being raised up in the church, you go all the way through the Sunday school process. It comes a time where you can go through the process of answering their questions that the pastor, the minister there would show you. And if you answer all their questions right, then when you're 12 years old, you can join the church and take communion for the very first time. Out of all my siblings, I'm the only one who did that. Because I'm a rule keeper. I was when I was a baby, I'm sure. I did everything they said to do. I stood in the back of that Methodist church that day. Everybody walked by and told me how happy they were for me. But I stood there and thought, for what? I didn't have a clue what they were talking about. You learn some information, you recite it back to them. That's not the same as something coming from. And so in that United Methodist Church, I'm not saying that everybody who goes through doesn't understand. I didn't understand. And I walked out that day, and I was just as lost as before. But I didn't know anything about being lost. The gospel really hadn't been shared with me. Going through our teenage years, my younger brother began to date a gal who was in the DeSoto Christian Church. Her dad was an elder in the DeSoto Christian Church. My family started going. Occasionally, I might. In that process, my younger brother became a follower of Jesus, still is highly, truly a follower of Jesus. My dad did. My mom did. One of my sisters did. I still have a brother and sister who say they're saved, but they never darkened the doors of the church. Ever. Mom and Dad wanted me, as a 16, 17-year-old teenager, to be baptized with long hair, wavy hair. I was baptized on a Sunday morning after talking with the pastor, had wet hair. I walked by, shook my hand, told me how happy they were for me. And I thought, as that 16, 17-year-old would think, for what? I got wet. Because you see, there was no understanding. There was no conviction. There was no confession. There was no asking forgiveness. It was religion. For the Jews, I'm sure there may have been some Jews who were very serious about everything they walked through and thought, but I'm sure a lot of them just did, like I did, walk through the routine. So my life continued down the rough road. My dad was really the first one who attempted to share the gospel with me one time when I came home after being gone all night. He did his best, kind. My dad was 6'2", 210 pounds, solid muscle, a carpenter. We feared my dad. You did not want to cross my dad. He was gentle this day. He shared the gospel with me. I scuffed the grass in the crack of the sidewalk. I said, yeah, dad, I know. I didn't know. Yeah. Went through, had something happen, and my life would have been gone. It didn't matter that I was christened as an infant. I didn't do that or make any decision. It didn't matter that I went through confirmation and took my first communion and got to be a member of a United Methodist Church. That didn't matter. Nothing had taken place in here. No decision had been made on my part. I was doing what others wanted me to do. Even that baptism as a teenager, just what others wanted me to do. So please hear my heart. This is gentle. This is not condescending. This is not condemning. I don't know your heart. All I know is what you might tell me. And what I might view by watching you over a period of time if I lived here in your community with you. But for me, I had done religious things, just like the Jews were doing religious things, but I was lost. Baptism, had that forgiven me of my sins, when I was baptized, I would have been forgiven of my sins. That doesn't do it. Christ, death on the cross, shedding his blood. He went to the cross, hung on the cross, said, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they're doing. I did not know what I was doing. I wasn't mean. I just flat did not know. So God brought me into a pastor's daughter's life. A Baptist pastor's daughter's life. And I began to hear the gospel. And so I was doing what I've always did. They gathered to go out and tell other people about Jesus on Monday night. And 4 Monday nights in a row, I was there. I was the silent one, but I was there. I'd hear the gospel be told in 3 to 4 different homes each Monday night. I could tell you how it was done and the scriptures. I had a good mind. I could memorize them. I was just lost and did not know I was lost. I just didn't know. As far on the outside, because I always thought, my older brother was the fighter, my younger brother was the charmer. I was just I'm going to do what's ever asked of me. And so I never bucked anything, so nobody suspected anything from me. And then everything's okay. But it wasn't. Until that second Tuesday night in January of 1978, and then it caved in on my spirit and soul. When Sandy said, "Rick, it's time for you to go home. It's your turn to pray and to wait." For the last 6 months of being out there, of my lostness, broke through the shell that I had for protection. And I confessed, "I'm lost. I need to be saved." And she just saw me, said, "I thought so." She had never questioned me. I've had all that religious background. I asked her to get her dad. He came in. He said, "You know what to do?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Then just do it." Again, I had been sharing the gospel. It had been implemented here, and now it was taking over here. When I asked him to forgive me of my sin and come into my life and change my life and make my life count for him to be my Lord and Savior, that's when forgiveness came. That's when I became his child. Almost 21 years of age, not quite, a month away from it. That's when forgiveness took place. That's when the joy filled my heart. That's when I know I was saved. That was a Tuesday night. Wednesday night, I let the church know. Sunday, I was baptized. I was on the front pew every Sunday because I didn't want anybody to respond to the invitation without me being able to talk to them. Because I knew what religion had left me as. It wasn't their fault. The enemy had my eyes blinded. I didn't see until Jesus let me see and opened my heart. That's when forgiveness of sin took place. Baptism is a celebration. It was a celebration of what happened to me on Tuesday night. When I was baptized on Sunday, it was a celebration of what happened to me on Tuesday night around midnight. And God washed me white as snow through his shed blood. I don't know how it all took place in your life, but if it took place, there are some, you could tell a story. Maybe not a storyteller like me, but you could tell your story. If you're like me, you didn't have a story. And you don't have a story, but you go through this. And you don't have a story about how God convicted you of your sin, forgave you of your sin. When you confess, "Yes, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me, Jesus." You go through this, and this hasn't taken place. This does nothing. This does not save. This will not keep somebody who's lost out of hell. So why are we baptized? The day of Pentecost, 3,000 were united, the first body of believers, and the church started. And I'm not baptized out here to live out here all by myself. I'm baptized as a part of a body of believers called the church, a local representation of the larger body of Christ. And so I am baptized out of obedience. Jesus went and did it. He wasn't lost. He didn't have sin to be forgiven. He said, it's necessary for me to fulfill all righteousness. It's necessary for me to fulfill all righteousness. It's necessary for you to fulfill all righteousness. So, I have the advantage that I don't know your story. So I want to ask a question. Do you have the story of Christ? When he came into your life, whether you're Lexi, or whether you're Rick Hitcher at 65, or my great-grandfather, Fred Adkins, at 92, when his story took place, God let him live to 96, to live 4 years as a believer in a nursing home. But he gave his life because somebody went to the nursing home and shared the gospel, and he heard the gospel and became a follower of Jesus. What about you today? Father, we're baptized because we know we have trusted you as our Savior. We want to follow your example, Jesus. And we want to be immersed because it pictures the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And we want to be just like you, Jesus. So in here today, Father, if there's somebody in here who has not yet said yes to you, would you stir their heart? Would you give them the confidence that they need to step forward? To say, I need to give my life to Jesus. Even if they've been a part of hanging around this body, maybe they're not a member here, but they just keep attending here. Father, if there's somebody here that needs your son Jesus, would you do what you did to me that night? Made yourself so real to me. Would you make yourself so real to them that they know it's not just church? That it's you. You want him. You want her to be yours. You hung the cross to pay the price of their sin, to forgive them of their sin, to give them eternal life, to give them new life. Father, if there's somebody here today, we're going to stand and we're going to sing. We're not going to prolong it, but if you're stirring somebody's heart, Father, would you draw them today to slip out from where they're standing, to come down the nearest aisle, to come to me and just say, Pastor Rick, I need to give my heart to Jesus. Father, we ask you to do this, and if there's no one here, God, that's okay. Thank you that everyone says they belong to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand. Let's stand. Will you come? Come now.
Yeah.
we lift you up today. I watched faces who could identify today. I saw the smiles. I saw the heads nod. God, thank you that this is a church that holds up high your word. And they know that church membership doesn't get us into heaven. They know it's by trusting you, Jesus. What you did on the cross, living the perfect life, dying to forgive me of my sin, being buried and then raising again the third day to give me the promise and the hope that one day, when this body dies, and it's laid to rest, that's not the end of this story. For you will raise me to spend eternity with you in heaven forever and ever and ever. Jesus, we thank you for that. Bless your people today as they go from here. May they be a blessing to this community. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.